So, hello everyone, and welcome to the first session of our webinar series on Historiana to teach history from different angles. Today we are here with Helen Snelson, who is EuroClio Ambassador and a member of the teaching and learning team of Historiana, to talk about how to use Historiana to teach about global history, and particularly she will talk about how to use coffee to stimulate a great learning of history. Helen, it's your moment to shine.
Hello everyone, it's lovely to see those of you that are here, and welcome also to those of you who will be listening later. Listening later does seem a very sane thing to do on what is here a very cold and stormy December evening, at the end of probably the longest ever autumn teacher term, I think. For the next hour or so, we will be hopefully stimulating some great learning of history through coffee. I hope so. And I hope you will enjoy what I'm going to say. Certainly, what we've got for you is hopefully some deep thinking to start off with about history, and then hopefully some nice ideas that you can take and adapt. You may have thought, coffee, really, in a classroom? But I'm hoping I can persuade you that is a great vehicle for doing some quite interesting things in history lessons. So I hope you are settled and that you got your coffee or another nice drink to hand, and thank you for joining us. So what I'm going to use throughout this hour as well are sources from the Europeana site, hence why I've put their logo on here, which are all available through Historiana. I am going to show you each different source that I use as part of a strategy to address a particular teaching challenge. And everything is adaptable. So everything, you can change it and use it with your specific pupils. You can use the idea with different sources, and I will try and explain possibilities for that as we go through. But hopefully by me explaining the thinking behind the ideas, you will feel inspired to create things for yourself and to do better things. So before I actually get on to any of the specific Europeana sources, I actually want to explain a history curriculum idea to you. This is the technical bit. I want to introduce you to the work of someone who's having a huge influence at the moment on history teachers in my part of the world, which is England. Mike Hill is having a huge influence on our curriculum thinking. In the middle of the first COVID lockdown, he and a group of other young history teachers took advantage of having more flexible working time to think about teaching history in more depth. And they went online and they produced an interesting course. And Mike Hill's thinking was so good that he was asked to write up his ideas for the journal Teaching History. And his ideas have been having a lot of influence over the course of the last year or so. Mike is German by origin and trained at the Institute for Education in London and now teaches in London. And amongst other things, he had been puzzling about this point, which is that for history teachers, the past is our greatest joy and our most fundamental problem. Even though history has at its heart of every lesson, the past itself is very strange, very remote, and very unfamiliar to us, and even more so to very young people. And by naming this, Mike said, well, you know, this means that our pupils can find it really difficult. Our pupils can complain that history is hard, that history might even be boring, because the past is such a strange, remote, and unfamiliar place. And he argues that we need to do more as history teachers to help our pupils with this fundamental problem. So what he'd done was he went back to the work of a man called Nelson Goodman, which was written in the USA in 1978. And he noticed that Goodman argued that all of our understandings of reality are made within the mind. And that as humans, we constantly create and reshape different worlds or world versions through a process that he, that's Goodman, called world making. Now, that's not necessarily a historical point of view, of course. That is as true for fiction as it is for history. But history is, of course, very different from fiction. History is about paying very close attention to verifiable evidence. I don't need to tell you that as a bunch of historians. But history is nevertheless created and imagined. We cannot go back to the past. Instead, we create evidence-based histories that can be contested and can be challenged by others using the evidence base. And Mike argues that as history teachers, we can use this knowledge of world making to do the following: to transform our pupils' ideas about the past from something patchy and inert into something coherent and richly textured, so that in their minds they can picture and they have images. And we've got to do this because, well, if our students' knowledge is patchy, they're going to struggle to use their knowledge of the past for any purpose at all. And if they've got inert knowledge of the past, then it's not going to touch them. It doesn't have any meaning for them. But of course, there is a problem here, because Goodman's world making is invisible. It goes on in our pupils' heads, in any person's heads. Also, as we all know, our pupils have ideas about the past that they don't just get from our history lessons. Lovely as we'd like to think it is that pupils learn just from us, that's not true. We all know that their families, their communities, social media, so many other things have an influence on our pupils' understanding of the past. And this led Mike to think deeply about what difference we as history teachers can make. We can't get inside our pupils' heads, but we can plan deliberately to build our students' understanding of the past. And this is what he called world building. So on the left, it's a term borrowed from literary theory, is world building, and it describes the gradual process in which authors carefully develop and construct a setting for their stories. And so in history, what that means is that the teacher needs to start by thinking, what are the core features? What are the building blocks of past events that must be learned by pupils? And the teacher pays careful attention to gradually building the imagined past, sometimes starting with the small and taking the narrative wider, perhaps by starting with the story of one person's life or with a really fascinating object or picture. Sometimes the teacher might start with an overview, such as a big timeline, and then move on to more specific things. But Mike argues very persuasively that as we teach school history topics to pupils, we need to be thinking really carefully about how we build their understanding of the world that these events took place in, so that they can use and they can connect what they learn into something meaningful. So Mike talks about, and I quote him, carefully planning to construct cohesive and evocative mental landscapes into which teachers and pupils can enter together, and which leave pupils able to navigate and roam this imagined world with confidence and purpose. And that's the process which Mike is trying to explain on this diagram, which I've taken from his article here. So the teacher is deliberately planning, the pupil then is able to world make, and both together have a sense of an imagined past. So that was my quite complex curricular development to start off with. But what on earth has all that got to do with coffee, I hear you say? All right, you might be now needing a coffee after that technical bit, but what I want to suggest is that we can use coffee, or rather sources of evidence about coffee, stories of coffee in the past, to help our students build worlds, to understand complex concepts, to understand complex processes, to understand complex connections, all of which can be hard for young minds to understand. And even if our students work hard and are high attaining, they just haven't been alive very long, and they don't have enough previous knowledge to help them make sense of what we teach them, unless we deliberately plan to help them. And coffee can help, and not just by drinking it. So that's what I'm going to argue. So I'm going to take us through a number of teaching challenges and suggest to you how coffee can help. My first teaching challenge is how to help students understand that the world was and is connected. And so, let's start with a map. A map of the world in about 1600. Now, if your students are like mine were, they are really quite lacking in knowledge of where things are in the world, never mind where things were in the world. And I always taught with a really big map of Europe on the wall that was frequently referred to in lessons. But I also think it's important for students to know that every map is an interpretation, not an inert fact. A map is, by definition, a selection of what could be shown for a specific purpose. And therefore, a map says something about the world in which it was created. So I like to use historic maps as well as more contemporary maps, and here is one. Let's have a look at it. I could tell a class that this map was created by a European in about the year 1600. And then I could ask my class, what did Europeans know about the world in 1600, and what didn't they know about the world in 1600? And hopefully you and your students would come up with ideas such as, they knew quite a lot about Africa, because when we can look at that map carefully and closely, then you can see that there is a very definite line around Africa and lots written on the continent. And they seem to know quite a lot about the western coast of the Americas, but not much about the interior of North America, look. And not much about the western coast of North America either. And they don't seem to know that Australia and Antarctica exist. Now that in itself can be quite mind-blowing for young students. We could, of course, immediately show a map from earlier and a map from later and look at the change. That would be something we could do. But what instead I would like to suggest we could do with this is to put this onto more slides or on a worksheet. I've just put it all on one slide so that you can see it. Or perhaps you could create a Historiana e-learning activity very much like it. But let me explain the idea behind what we could do here. Here is the map again, and students would most likely need a modern map or be able to internet search in order to help them find the places. But simply what I'd be asking them to do first is say, okay, all these places listed were connected to coffee in the 1600s. Find them on the map. So as you can see, they're going to need a bigger version of this map. They're perhaps going to need something like a Historiana e-learning activity to be able to move the places around and label a map. And they're also going to be able to need to refer to a modern map or do an internet search. But with that support as an activity, hopefully they could simply place those places on a map. Because all of them, apart from Constantinople, which we'll need some translation for them, because of course that's modern Istanbul, I believe all of those places, otherwise they will find on a modern map. All right. Part of doing that activity as a start to this is to get them to look at the map closely. It's a vehicle for getting students to really focus in more depth. Once the finding task is done, I could then say to my students, coffee grows in equatorial regions and sub-equatorial regions. And so then I could ask them to suggest which of these places were coffee producing areas and which were coffee consuming places. Of course, some of them may be both, but some of them, for example, England is definitely not a coffee producing place. It's obviously a coffee consuming place, as is Paris. And then I would briefly tell my students that we know coffee producing and drinking started in the area around Yemen and Ethiopia, where it can grow. It then moved north to the Muslim world. Notice my deliberate use of this concept in my teacher talk. The Muslim world is a concept I want students to get used to by hearing me talk about it so that they become familiar with what the Muslim world is. So coffee production and consumption moved north into the Muslim world to Mecca. Then it went the consumption of coffee to Cairo, to Constantinople, now Istanbul, certainly by the 1500s. Coffee was then traded into Europe for drinking from the 1600s. And that was as a result of trade between the Muslim Ottoman Empire and European people. So then I would pause and say to them, how is the coffee travelling to Europe? And we could have a discussion as a group of students. And hopefully looking at our map in detail, we'll be able to see, well, it must be travelling via the sea, via the Mediterranean. We might even have some smart children who could work out that it must be travelling up that big river called the Danube. And then at some point it must be carried over land. How is it being carried over land in 1600? Well, probably on pack horses or in carts. Can you see how we were building a sense of what the world was like in 1600? And then I would say to my students, in an attempt to avoid dependence of trading with the Ottoman Empire, whose capital was the great city of Constantinople, now Istanbul, Dutch merchants took coffee beans to Java and to Sumatra and organised their cultivation. How were the coffee beans transported back to Europe? Obviously by sea, by ship. What does that tell us about Dutch merchants? I would ask the pupils. Gosh, it tells us, doesn't it, that the Dutch merchants had some really good ideas. That they obviously had some good ships also that could travel a long way round the world. And that they had plenty of money to invest in travel to almost the other side of the world. So let's pause and notice as teachers what's happening there, because as I am introducing this world through coffee. I am introducing the ideas of trade and travel around the world, of connection and of competition. And you probably have specific topics that you teach in the 1600s. You might be teaching the Reformation. You might be teaching the early European exploration. There'll be many things that you teach in relation to the 1600s, perhaps the 30 years of war in Germany. But can you see how with just part of one lesson, with one map, and with a theme of coffee to start us off, we can build a sense of what the world was like in the 1600s. That is, what the world was like that these events are happening in. It's a world where Europeans were trading further afield than ever before. It's a world where the Dutch were controlling Sumatra and Java. It's a time when there was something called the Muslim world that everybody would have been aware of, and the Ottoman Empire, which was very influential on European lives, and so on and so on. Now, which terms, which phrases, which concepts you choose to emphasize in your talk and with your students and in your questioning depends on which places you want to highlight. And that will depend on what topics are on your curriculum, what specific things they're going to have to learn about the 1600s, your students. But what you can do with a map and with the story of coffee is to start to build a world by giving a sense of place and to introduce them to concepts and terms that pupils will need to become familiar with if they are going to gain a secure knowledge and a secure understanding of the specific events and topics you're going to teach them. That is, if you're going to connect the world together. It really doesn't take much time to do what I've done, but it's time really well spent to make a world in their minds, which will then mean that their knowledge becomes more sticky. Okay, so that's one idea. Let's move to another. That was a big map. Let's now go small to build a world. I'm going to read you a short description. Please look at this lovely picture as I read you the short description and think what you can learn about England in about 1690 by listening to my description and looking at this picture. Look at the picture and step into it. Sit on a bench with the other men. A serving man will bring you coffee. Would you like some tobacco for your pipe, sir? It's best Virginia, grown on the plantations in the New World. Since the first coffee house was opened in London by a migrant to this city in 1652, this stimulating drink has become very fashionable. You are here because it is the place to be seen. As a merchant of London, you have put on your good jacket. You have powdered your wig. You are here to catch up on the news. The coffee house is where you will find out what is happening in London and the wide world beyond. You are here to learn. These coffee houses are called penny universities. Alcohol dulls the mind. Coffee stimulates. There are great thoughts to be had and to be shared over coffee. Men such as the great scientist Isaac Newton frequent the coffee houses. You are here to network. Powerful organisations such as the East India Company grew out of coffee house networking. King Charles II has been restored to the throne of his father, and he is suspicious of the coffee houses. Like rulers in Mecca and in Constantinople before him, He has tried and failed to ban them. The women of London don't like them either. In 1674, they complain that their husbands spend too long drinking the base, black, thick, nasty, bitter, stinking, nauseous puddle water. You seem to be enjoying your coffee, sir. Are you sitting comfortably? Let's see what you have learnt today. Okay, so there, obviously, I was treating you like my students. I would be showing the students the picture and reading that description. So my question to you is, or to my students, what sort of people are in this public space in the later 1600s? What sort of people are they? They're men. They're wealthy. They're merchants. They're people who want to learn, people who want connections. I might then ask my students, why have the London coffee houses of the 1600s been described as the internet of their day? And of course, it's because they were places for news, for networking, for learning. Can you see how my questioning after reading my description would help students to reflect on what they've heard and to draw out the history? Think about the map we just looked at. Where might the coffee these men are drinking have come from? What places around the world might be talked about in the coffee houses? Again, hopefully you can see how pupils would be helped to make connections between the big map and the small picture. I could ask the pupils, how would you describe the London of the later 1600s from what you have heard? I would encourage them to come up with words such as energetic, fashionable, full of ideas, controversial, full of trade, possibly even full of enslaved labour, some of them may know. And I could get them to be curious by asking them, what else do you want to know about the 1600s? So, with an image like this and questioning like this, we are explicitly building worlds so that our pupils can make sense of the specific events and people that they study in the course of the 1600s. Again, of course, the specific image you choose depends on your pupils and the topics you're going to teach. You might choose the first coffee house in Venice or Vienna or Paris or somewhere else instead of London. You could do something similar for coffee in the 18th century or in the 19th century. The strategy is the same, using a map and using an image with a good, rich description. Pupils can get a sense of global connectedness. And global connectedness is a real teaching challenge, how we get students to understand that the world was connected even centuries ago. So what I hope I've done is suggest how you might use coffee to deal with that teaching challenge. But we must move on. I want to move on to another teaching challenge, which is keeping the past complex. What we've got is an e-activity already published on Historiana, and this e-activity is an example of how we can use the topic of coffee to bring the past, which is complex, the past which is nuanced, and to bring discussion of values into our classrooms using coffee. In keeping the past complex, what we're doing here is using coffee to make the study of history less Eurocentric and to build a sense of the values of the world in the 18th century and the belief systems of people in the 18th century, to make it clear what values and belief systems these people were acting within, and that it's too simplistic to say they were good or bad. There is real complexity and nuance to those ideas. and also to challenge ourselves that the world is complex, that trade is complex, that interrelationships are complex, that values and belief systems are complex and have implications and consequences, both intended and unintended. And using something as simple as coffee can keep the framing simple enough to then go into very big ideas with quite young students. And of course, you could do similar things with sugar. You could do similar things with tea or with cotton or with any other commodity which is useful to your particular locality. In my context, for example, in England, there's a lot of learning about the 18th century Industrial Revolution and the cotton mills of Lancashire. And if we fail to link up that the cotton that was being woven in Lancashire in the mills of Cottonopolis, which was the name for Manchester at the time, if we're failing to make that connection with the enslaved labour in the southern states of America that was producing that cotton, then I think we're failing as history teachers, because we're failing to be representative of the past, and we're failing to make important connections which will lead to modern understandings. So lots of interesting things you can do with the history of commodities, of which coffee is the one that I'm focusing on today. So let me move on. I've talked a little already here about the teaching of complex concepts and processes in that past example, but just to take that a little further, you can explore colonial capitalism through coffee, through cotton, through tea. You could use a variety of sources about coffee across time, and you could ask pupils to write a narrative explaining the journey of a coffee bean in about 1800. That would be an activity for younger students, perhaps. And it's a way, therefore, to show complex processes, in this case, international trade, as Valeria was talking about before. And these processes are, as we have said, hard for younger pupils to understand. Here's an example presented for younger students. This is the beginning of a development using another one of the tools on the Historiana e-activity builder. And you could even use this, I think, down at primary school level, or you could use it at a more complex level. Whether you use it at primary level or more complex level rather depends on the amount of text you put around the images. But essentially what you're doing here is showing, and if I click one more time, it will reveal what this comes to. You're showing the link between the metropole and the colonies. How the metropole is using coffee, and in this case, students would first go to a source from the 1870s showing coffee being grown in one of the colonies. That's my image up here, and then they would follow the coffee being shipped to Europe, and depending on how capable the students were, you could put lots of description here or very little description here, and then you could connect up the various different images in the whole process. Hopefully you can get the idea just from my simple short demonstration here. Higher attainers, you could add that colonial capitalist enterprises such as the Lloyds of London and the British East India Company started out of coffee houses. But basically the idea is that you're tracing the bean to the cup and all the people and processes and decisions and implications that are involved on the journey. Of course, you could take a similar approach in a civics lesson, thinking about bean to plant to cup in hand in 2021 for coffee. You don't necessarily have to do this in a historical way. Okay. You might want to look at this as an idea. You could explain the concept of convenience using coffee. For example, coffee essence, which is on the left, which I'm sure, I know Valeria's here, no Italian would ever drink that coffee essence. It's absolutely disgusting, but it was terribly fashionable and terribly useful camping. And of course, therefore, for soldiers on expedition, it was made in Scotland and shipped around the British Empire in order to make quick drinks. And of course, later, instant coffee, which in my world is also a terrible thing, but instant coffee is still drunk in large quantities and was made first, I believe, in about 1938. I read somewhere that in 1945, the American army was being powered by 40 million cups of instant coffee. So there you go, you could get into the concept of convenience, or you could use coffee to explain the concept of marketing to students. On the right, there is a lovely Dutch instant coffee advert explaining how marketing happens, all of which, of course, are concepts that are important for students to understand, sometimes in a historical context, sometimes for the concept of civics lessons. So whenever we have a complex concept to explain, we don't need to step out of period. We could use a potentially simple product such as coffee or tea or chocolate or cotton in order to explain the more complex concept. Okay, let me introduce one final teaching challenge before I stop today, and that is the idea of challenging stereotypes as well. To build a world, young people need to have their preconceptions challenged. And this next example of a coffee-related source is one that could be used to challenge stereotypes as a teacher when you start to teach the period of the 1700s. Every class and group of young people, of course, is different, but some pupils may have some rather stereotyped views of Muslim cultures and society. Pupils might have a view of Islamic culture and therefore of the Ottoman Empire that is very male dominated and quite underdeveloped. And to find out what their preconceptions are before you start teaching the Ottoman Empire in the 1700s, you could ask pupils to draw a sketch, or you could ask your pupils to describe in words and phrases what they might see if there was an image in front of them of people drinking coffee in the 1700s in the Ottoman world. Just imagine what your pupils might come up with if you asked them what would pop into their heads about drinking coffee in the Ottoman world in the 1700s. And then reveal your coffee drinking image. Today we still associate coffee with Turkey, and coffee was drunk in all sorts of settings in the Ottoman Empire. In 1790s Istanbul, there were over 1600 coffee houses. Almost one in every eight shops was selling coffee, so everybody was into it. In 1840, there were 2,500 coffee houses. And during this time, one of the justifications that a woman could present to divorce her husband in the Ottoman world was that he didn't provide his household with enough coffee. And you could spend some time thinking about what this image suggests about Ottoman society. And likely answers would include that women's spaces included coffee drinking, that there was some real prosperity and affluence in the Ottoman world. These are not women who are lacking in money. And again, adding this image in at the start of a topic where you know you're going to be referring to the Ottoman Empire a lot, to the relations of various other European capitals with Constantinople, means that your pupils will have some mental images that frame and contextualize the specific information about an event connecting the Ottoman world with the rest of Europe. So a little bit of perhaps prejudice busting going on with an image here. I think we need to draw the formal bit to a close, and I hope that focusing on coffee has stimulated you, if I can use the joke again, to think further about world building for your students and how you need to think for each topic that you teach about how you can teach at the beginning so that your pupils can move from having patchy and inert knowledge of the past to having coherent knowledge that resonates and makes sense for them, so that they want to learn more and so that they can make meaning of the past for themselves as beginning historians. And I hope that by focusing on some solutions to some teaching challenges relating to world building through teaching complex concepts, complex processes, and complex connections, you can see how you could adapt the ideas I have presented with or without coffee. And if you want more coffee, our wonderful EuroClio colleague Bridget Martin has created another e-learning activity on coffee's consequences that you can find published on Historiana e-learning activity section.
Thank you, Helen, so much for today's session. It was a pleasure, and I can't wait to see what Historiana holds for us next.